Hey, so I made a video for you guys a couple days ago, overcoming Catholic objections to speaking in tongues, and I promised you one about Protestants. I said the arguments are different. And you know, I was a Protestant for 30 years and I debated a lot of cessationists, Protestants who believe the gifts have ceased. And I came up with five of their most common arguments. And actually one is the same as one of the Catholic arguments I gave. So that's gonna be the fifth argument. So if you've seen the Catholic video, you only gotta watch the first four arguments and you'll have everything. So first off, the Protestant argument is a little bit more logical than the Catholics, I would have to say, because they reject all the spiritual gifts. They think they all ended. Catholics, on the other hand, freely accept healings and miracles and prophecies, just speaking in tongues. Some, a very small minority, reject. And Protestants, I would say it's about 60, 40, 40% of them reject it. And you might think it would be higher. I'm just going by, you know, personal experience, 30 years debating cessationists. And you say, well, the Southern Baptists don't believe in the gifts. Like, technically, on paper, they don't. But I was baptized in the Holy Spirit by an ordained Southern Baptist minister. He was a Navy chaplain, but he was an ordained Southern Baptist. And I've met many Southern Baptists who believe in the gifts. So technically, on paper, the denomination official stance is the gifts no longer exist. However, it's so prevalent in Southern Baptist communities that I think it was like 10 years ago, the Southern Baptist Convention had to change a ruling, and they now allow missionaries who speak in tongues to be Southern Baptist missionaries. They used to disqualify you, but they had so many missionaries getting baptized in the Holy Spirit and speaking in tongues, they would have lost half of their missionaries if they kept that requirement. So, like I said, this argument that they have is the gifts have ceased. And these are the five reasons I give. Number one, the Bible says the gifts ceased. Number two, it was only for the apostles. So after the last apostle died, the gifts ceased. Number three, not everybody's healed now. If there's a gift, you know, like I said, they believe in all the gifts are gone. So why isn't everybody healed? If you have the gift of healing, why don't you go in the hospital and heal everybody in the hospital? Number four, God is a God of order. And I see these churches and everybody's out of order. And number five, this is the one that Catholics agree, the same argument as some Catholics have. Everybody understood what was being said. So we'll start with number one, the Bible says it. And most cessationists will say they got this theology from the Bible, but according to Protestant, evangelical Protestant Bible scholar and former Dallas theological professor, Dr. Jack Deere, he said this argument arose when the reformers needed to defend themselves against their enemies, the Catholics, because miracles and spiritual gifts were going on in the Catholic Church, and the Catholic Church was saying, this proves our doctrine is true. Where are your miracles? And the reformers had no miracles happening in the Reformed churches. So they had to argue, well, they ceased. Your miracles must be fake. And although they weren't total cessationists like the cessationists today, Martin Luther said it's not normative, like it's happening in the Catholic Church, they're all fake. You know, God can still use miracles and gifts, but it's not the norm, like it's happening in the Catholic Church. It's happening. So they had to come up with an argument. So being sola scriptura guys, the best argument would just show them point blank in the Bible, but it's not in there. So they had to do what you call theological deduction, like prove, well, this says this, and this means this, and this is why. And one of the things they said was to authenticate the apostles, and we'll get there. But over the years, they needed stronger arguments. They knew that argument was weak. So in the early 19th century, Princeton theologian B.B. Warfield came up with this theory. He said there was three times that God used miracles in salvation history. The first was with Moses and Joshua. The second was Elijah and Elisha. And the last was Jesus and apostles. He doesn't need to use them anymore. And one verse they use to back it up is 1 Corinthians 13:10. So we'll go there and we'll give, this is their best argument. St. Thomas Aquinas says, give them, you know, defeat their best argument. So 1 Corinthians 13:10 says, but when the perfect comes, the imperfect will pass away. And they say that's talking about the gifts. So we'll read the whole thing in context. We'll go from chapter 13, from verse 8 to verse 13. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For our knowledge is imperfect, and our prophecy is imperfect. But when the perfect comes, the imperfect will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall understand fully, even as I have been fully understood. So faith, hope, and love abide, these three, but the greatest of these is love. So they get out of that, that prophecies have ended because the perfect have came. He's like, wait a minute, Jesus hasn't returned yet. No, that's what most Bible scholars believe that this is talking about, when either Jesus returns and we go to heaven and we'll know everything. We won't need the gifts. We'll be in heaven. We'll see Jesus face to face. He's the perfect that comes again when he returns. But through the theological deduction, there's like, no, that's talking about the Bible. When the Bible comes, and now we have the Bible, so we don't need the gifts. Well, they had the Bible. They had the Old Testament Bible. And did they know that there was going to be a New Testament Bible? I mean, they were writing letters in the first century, but it wasn't until the Council of Rome, 382 AD, that the church decided which books would be in the New Testament. So their deduction reasoning says, well, it was to authenticate the apostles. We needed miracles. And this is their theology. This is cessationist theology. We needed miracles and gifts to, so people knew that the apostles were messengers of God. And the verse they use for that is in Acts 14, verse 3. And it says, so they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the word of his grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. See, he authenticated them. No, it says, the Lord who bore witness to the word of his grace, bore witness to their message, not to the apostles, to the message. And the reasoning goes, the apostles did miracles to authenticate themselves so they would be authenticated messengers of God. Well, Stephen and Philip were not apostles. And if you read about Stephen and Philip, God used miracles, signs, and wonders with both of those men. And they were deacons. And taking it a little further, when Jesus sent out the 72, we know from the book of Acts, there was only 7 deacons at this time. So they weren't deacons or apostles. There was 12 apostles and 7 deacons. Who were these 72? They were regular disciples like you and me. And he sent them out. He told them to go in people's houses and heal them. And they came back talking about healing and casting out demons and all these spiritual things. If you remember, they say they were rejoicing. Read about 72, read about Stephen and Philip. So then they say, well, if these gifts are real, if people are really being healed, how come everyone's not being healed? And how come I haven't seen any healings? Well, I had a medical doctor on a few weeks back, Dr. Richard Gallagher, who happened to be on the board of directors, or the medical board rather, at Lourdes. And he said he's reviewed over 500 medically documented miraculous healings at Lourdes alone, at this one Catholic shrine. So there is documented healing, and it's happening in the Catholic Church, praise the Lord. But not everybody's healed. It's obvious not everybody is healed. I know godly men and women who have died of diseases they weren't healed of. John Wimber, a Protestant who had the gift of healing, has also had documented healings. You can read some of James White, Dr. James White, another medical doctor, confirmed and documented these healings that John Wimber was used by God to heal people. John Wimber died of cancer. So sometimes God doesn't heal everybody, and that's scriptural. You'll see right here in the Gospel of John, chapter 5, verse 1 through 9. After this, there was a feast. There was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool in Hebrew called Bethesda, which has five porticos. In these lay a multitude of invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man was there who has been there for 30 years. When Jesus saw him and knew that he had been lying there a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be healed?" The sick man answered, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is troubled, and while I'm going, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise up, take up your pallet and walk." And at once the man was healed, and he took up his pallet and he walked. There was a portico full of lame and blind people, but Jesus only healed one that day. Why doesn't Jesus heal everybody? Why don't we heal everybody, you know, with the gift of healing? Well, for my cessationist Calvinist friend, it should be, well, it's God's will. That should be good enough. You know, we shouldn't question that. But God does give us an answer. 1 Peter 6:7. "In this you rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold, which though perishable is tested by fire, may redound to praise and glory and honor the revelation of Jesus Christ." Jesus allows us to go through sickness and trials and tribulations so he can make us like gold, purify us. This is biblical. So God has a reason. And also in 2 Corinthians 13:5, it says, "We suffer so we may receive the comfort and comfort others who are suffering with the comfort we receive from God." That's another reason God allows us to suffer. So it's biblical that not everybody is healed. And then the next argument, God is a God of order. Oh, John MacArthur always used this. Oh, you see, he'll take, I love these guys. They'll take the most whacked out church where, you know, people are acting crazy. You know, there'd be millions of services where the gifts are being used in order, but they'll pick the one, you know, a few, just like these guys who hate certain Catholic masses will pick out one out of a million that is done wrong and say, "Yeah, you can't go to that mass," but I'm digressing. So John MacArthur will always show some whacked out church where people are speaking in tongues. It was like, God's a God of order. He wouldn't allow that. And they get that. It's biblical. He is a God of order. And they get that in 14. First Corinthians 14:14. "But in all things should be done decently in order." Decently and in order. But they skip right over. They don't understand expository preaching. These guys always talk about expository preaching, but they skip right over the verse right before it. 14:39. 1 Corinthians 14:39. As clear as day says, "So my brethren, earnestly desire to prophesy, and do not forbid speaking in tongues. But in all things, do it decently and orderly." That's the context. Now, he's telling the Corinthians they need to be in order, because if you read the book of Corinthians, they were way out of order. Like, using the spiritual gifts and speaking out of tongues out of order was just one of their many problems. These people were going to prostitutes right after church. They were cheating on each other with family members. This church was a mess. If any church should be not allowed to use the spiritual gifts, it should have been the church at Corinth. But instead, he says, do not forbid speaking in tongues. And the chapters before that, all 12, all 13, and all 14, is explaining how to use the gifts. He's not telling them don't use them. He's saying, this is what you're doing wrong. This is what you need to fix it. This is what you're doing wrong. This is what you need to do to fix it. And then he ends with, you know, God is a God of order. So, you know, and you say, well, I see all these counterfeits out there, you know? Yeah, you know, I see counterfeits too. You know, if my father wanted to give me a ton of money, a fortune of money, would I say, no, Dad, I don't want that money. I know you're wealthy, you could afford it. But I've seen a lot of counterfeit money on the street, you know? I work in sales. I see counterfeit money all the time. I don't want it because there's a lot of counterfeit money. You know? Oh, there's a lot of false tongues. Well, there's a lot of false teachers too. Jesus said there would be a lot of false teachers. So should we stop having teachers? Jesus said there would be false prophets. Should we stop having prophecy? If something has an imitation, if the devil is going to imitate something, there has to be something real it's imitating. So trust the church, or well, if you're Protestant, I'm sorry, trust your Bible. Catholics, we could trust our church and the Bible because the church gave us the Bible, but I'm talking to Protestants right now. If you're a Protestant, trust your Bible. You know, earnestly desire spiritual gifts. Paul tells you to earnestly desire to prophesy and do not forbid speaking in tongues. And then the last one. Oh, everybody understood it. And they get that from Acts 2, where tongues of fire come on them and they're speaking in tongues. And the Medes, the Persians, the Arabians, everybody from all over the world can hear them in their language. And they're hearing praises to God. You know, they're hearing the gospel. So everybody could hear it, right? Well, in that instance, God used it that way. But in 1 Corinthians 14:2, Paul says this: "For one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God. For no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the Spirit." And then he goes on, 1 Corinthians 14:16-19. "Otherwise, if you bless with the Spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you are saying? For you may give thanks well enough, but the other man is not edified." Listen, I thank God I speak in tongues more than all y'all. "Nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue." So no, they did not always understand tongues. And again, he gives instructions for that. If you're going to speak in tongues publicly, where everybody can hear, make sure someone has the gift of interpreting that tongues. If there's not, he says, pray to yourself. You can pray the tongues very quietly where no one hears it but you and God. And going back to Acts chapter 2, not everybody in Acts chapter 2 understood it either. Because if you read Acts 2:13, it said some were mocking the apostles and said they were drunk. So apparently they weren't getting a message from God. God was allowing an interpretation somehow. Maybe the people that were hearing it had the gift of interpretation for that moment. I don't know. God is God. I'm not God. And you Calvinist cessationists, you know that. God is sovereign. He could do whatever he wants. So stop putting God in a box. Stop being afraid of the Holy Spirit. And earnestly desire spiritual gifts, especially prophesying. But do not forbid speaking in tongues. God bless and stay Catholic. Or become Catholic.